John Singer Sargent Gassed. I saw it first in Boston in 2002, which was the last time it came to the United States. It was in a retrospective of John Singer Sargent's paintings. Since then, I've seen it about 8 times. And I'm going to show you the story of how it got here, how we put it together, basically. So I'm giving you a behind-the-scenes look at how the painting got to where it is in the exhibition today, and a little bit about the exhibition. And then if we have time at the end and not everybody's left, we'll have time for the questions and hopefully answers. But so when it got, before it got here, we had to design the space for it, and we had to design the space for its crate. There were 2 crates that it came in. The crates, of course, the main crate that the painting was in is a lot bigger than the painting itself. So we built the doors from the loading dock. We built the loading dock. We built the doors from the loading dock and the doors that go into the back of the gallery specifically to fit the crate of this painting. And so if we get anything that's taller in here over the next quarter century that I'm here. I am going to retire before the bicentennial, by the way. And you heard that, Mike. It's the truth. It's going to happen. And so what you're seeing here is the 53-foot truck that backed up to it came from Nashville. I brought the main preparator from the Frist Center in Nashville. And what I'm going to show you is what I saw when I went there. Because before I saw how it was actually put together and put up on the wall, I had a lot of nightmares about John Singer Sargent Gassed. And so brought their head preparator here with it, and he basically was our boss and told us what to do. So you see the crate there inside the truck in the left screen. Is it your left? Yeah, I don't know. Anyway, the one on that side. It came in a crate. It came inside a traveling frame. And then the frame itself came in its own frame. And the frame is original to the painting. And it came in 4 pieces. And I'll show you how that was put together. And then you can see that when it was going in the door, and we had it on very low lifts to take it in there, and we were watching because we had all these camera crews. We were making sure that it did indeed go through the door, mainly because it was about 12 degrees outside, and we wanted to get it inside because the truck was climate controlled, but between the truck and inside the space, we had to move it fairly quickly. Now, so the pictures I'm going to show of you being put together, when we were putting it together here and getting it up on the wall in the exhibition, I didn't have time to take photographs. But I did take photographs when it was at the Frist, when it was put on in the exhibition at the Frist. So you're going to see that, so you won't recognize any of the crew that we used here and any of our other museum folks. But we did it exactly the same way and uncovered it and put it up in the same fashion. So the crate itself opens from one side. Just the side that comes off weighs about 800 pounds. The crate itself is about 2,400 pounds. So it took a lot of people just to get ready for when the side of the crate came off. As I said, the painting itself, this is the first time that I saw it in the frame, in the traveling frame. You can just see the ghostly image of the painting inside there. There was a lot of, okay, let's take everything real slow and carefully here. And I basically stayed out of the way because I just wanted to observe everything that they were doing. Then the traveling frame was lifted out of the traveling trunk. I didn't notice in this picture until our archivist, Jonathan Casey, pointed it out, but there's one of my favorite people in the picture on the wall, John Lennon. And that was in the hallway there at the Frist. Then on the right, it was laid down in the traveling frame. It's a solid piece behind, so the painting itself is not laying on the floor. then the traveling frame itself is then it was strapped in there. It was covered with plastic, and then it had braces that held it within the frame itself. There was never anything actually on the cover, on the face of the painting. Was then lifted out. The painting about 10 years ago was put on stretched on an aluminum stretcher, and so it was a lot easier to handle than the old wooden stretcher that was on there. But when people are handling this, of course, they can't touch the painting. So you have a very slim ledge to hold on to lift it up. And so that was the biggest thing that everybody was told then and was told here was do not touch the front of the painting. The back of it you can touch. Then after it was removed from the frame, it was stood up on Ethfoam blocks and against the wall that was there. And at this point, you could really see the painting itself emerging. When the frame was uncrated, I'm sorry this is a bad picture, but when the frame was uncrated and laid on its front, then I saw in the plastic there is one of the original labels for the exhibition at the Royal Academy in 1926 in London. This was a year after Sargent died. And so to see the original label on there, you're not gonna see this in the exhibit. You just have to take my word for it, it's there. So the frame itself, of course it was laid on the floor with blankets and plastic underneath. The frame itself was screwed back together at the corners. It had metal plates that went on the corners as braces that looked like they were made at the beginning of the Bronze Age. But it really holds the thing together, and bolts go through the frame. And when it's completely put together, then what holds the painting on the wall are braces underneath the frame. It's not hung. It's actually set on these really heavy-duty angle braces that are screwed into the wall, into the plywood, and then it will be set on there. It was set on there. And, of course, this all had to be very level, and we found out that the painting in our exhibition is level while the floor isn't. So then this is the painting ready to go into the frame. It's up on a rolling frame. We didn't have to do this because we were real close to where it came into the building. And this was before the scariest part of all, because then the painting has to be carried over to the frame upside down and laid in the frame, and then there are braces that go from the frame over the back of the painting to hold it in the frame. So very carefully place in the frame, and it was just watch where you're going, make sure it was all in there, and it will settle down in there by itself, really, and that's exactly what happened. Once it was secured in the frame, then it was basically lifted up again. It took about 12 people for each of the lifts, and it was set on Ethfoam blocks. And then it had to be walked to the wall to actually set it up on the brackets. So setting it up on the brackets where it's above the floor, that's really where it gets, again, very hard to do. So you had people behind watching and making sure that everybody was out of the way of it. Then once it was up in place fairly close to the wall, then ladders had to be brought in on each end so a person could be up on the ladder to steady the top of the painting. It's about 1,400 pounds at this point. Okay, now it's up on the brackets, put into place. I didn't plan on this, but the color of our wall that we built specifically for this painting in the exhibition is almost exactly the same color they chose at the Frist. And we had a completely different designer and everything, and our president CEO actually was the final say on the color of the paint, and it was almost identical to what they used at the Frist. The wall that the painting is on in our exhibition, when the painting leaves on June 4th, the wall will be torn down. And then that space will be made ready for the next exhibition that goes in there. So this is a true art exhibition. So there it was. There it is. That's exactly what it looked like in the gallery at the Frist. They had a little more ceiling height than we did in ours, but we measured, again, Stacy Peterson, our museum registrar, and I were in there measuring the floor right before it came and made sure we had enough room to lay this thing down on the floor. And so we did, with about a couple inches to spare. And I just put this in to show that I was actually there. That was back in the warm days in the summertime. And the reason we did all this, the reason we did everything that occurred, was for two reasons. One is because this is a national treasure of the United Kingdom. It's considered one of their national treasures. It normally lives at the Imperial War Museum in London on the South Bank. In their museum was built in a former insane asylum, and it was called Bedlam. So when you say it's Bedlam, it's the old insane asylum, and that's what they use today as their museum. When they took it out, we had a lot easier time here. When they took it out, they had to tear a hole in the wall, because it had been put in this gallery that it had been in for how many years, and it hadn't had to move. So they built, while it's been in the United States for the other three venues, and here, they've redone their gallery and actually have put access to get it back in there, because when it goes back in, it'll do exactly what you saw me just show. And the second reason we did that was so this wouldn't happen. We didn't want it going out the end of the building, and we didn't want it ended up on our heads. I thought it was funnier than that. I don't know.
We're just catching up with you.
Okay. And when we decided to do the exhibition, it was also, we talked, Matt Naylor and I talked about how we wanted the exhibition not only to include materials about the painting, because the painting is the exhibition, but also give it some context. As Laura said, that's my big word, is context. And also, I wanted stuff in the exhibition, so I had to be able to put some things on exhibit along with the painting. And so one of the things that I really wanted to do was to put a map in there from our collection, which shows where John Singer Sargent and his friend Henry Tonks traveled to the Western Front to find the scene that he painted. The kind of blobby thing over on this side is the map of Arras, France, and they traveled about 8 kilometers to the southwest to a place called Barriels, and there was a dressing station there, and when they got there, they both decided that that was the place that Sargent saw the scene that he should paint. And this was the description that Henry Tonks wrote about what they saw, and it said Sargent was very struck by the scene and immediately made a lot of notes. He also made lots of on-the-site drawings. We have these, a lot of these in the exhibition that are on the video screen that we've gotten from several sources that have the originals. And so as part of our education programming that Laura's working on, the students will actually look at these and see if they can find if he actually used these scenes or not in the final painting. He started the painting when he got back to England the end of August of 1918. He finished it in March 1919. And luckily, all of his drawings were saved. So when we wanted to do this, one of the things that Sargent said was he saw these men and they were completely unprepared for poison gas warfare. And they didn't have the right equipment. They had gas masks, but they didn't have the right kind of gas masks. They had uniforms that did not protect their skin from mustard gas. And we don't know exactly what the gas was, but we think it was probably mustard because of their blinding of the soldiers that were there at the dressing station. And so in doing this, we wanted to not talk about how poison gas is delivered. We do that fairly well in the main gallery. We wanted to talk more about detection and protection. How did they know there was poison gas coming? How could they protect themselves? And we did this because we not only wanted to talk about World War I, but because our reach, the history of World War I and the material culture, goes well beyond these doors up to present day. And so that's what we've taken with the three-dimensional aspect of this exhibition, in showing detection and protection from 1915 all the way to today. And if that isn't scary, and like I said, I like signal flags and carrier pigeons, and I have to deal with equipment from 1999 and stuff. That's a long way out of my comfort zone. But the first things that we put in, of course, were one of our publications from the collection. It shows one of the earliest gas masks that were used. On this side is the very modern model 1918 German gas mask, which a lot of the gas masks are based on still today. When we look at these, we say, well, how did they work? Well, that the face part went over their face, of course, like this, had to be very tight. And then the filter that screwed in at the bottom so it could be replaced, because these wore out when they got full, and they breathed up through layers of tissue, lime, and charcoal. And the lime they used was just like they put on the baseball diamonds to mark the base pass. So we show a lot of images from our collection, including the horse gas mask that's in the photograph here. If I had a real horse gas mask from World War I, I'd show it to you, but we don't have one yet. So anybody that's got one laying around, talk to me after the program. On the right is the gas alarm. It's a crank model. It's called a klaxon. These were developed from early car horns that were in use, and they developed these for the gas warning system. When you crank it, after the program, you can ask Laura how loud those are in her office. When someone comes in and she's behind her desk and someone, I don't know who, would crank one of those in her office. That one, just like it. And I took one of these. I was on Channel 41 News last week for their noontime, and Cynthia Newsom was interviewing me, and I had some of the objects. And I said, you want me to show you how this worked? And I said, it's going to make a little noise. And it did. So the audio man was back there turning all the dials back. Of course, from our collection, we were able to come up with lots of different images of protection against gas warfare. And we're very, very fortunate in this, and then our friend of our museums, Kip Lindberg, who's the curator of the U.S. Army Chemical Corps Museum near Rolla, he loaned us a lot of good materials and good information about beyond World War I. And he gave us entire collection of World War I protection and detection, World War II posters, and so told people what it would smell like, what their gas masks they should use, and how they could actually get around some of the gas. But the gas itself in World War II was exactly the same. There was no poison gas used in anger against combat troops in World War II. The masks there that you see, the masks in the carrier, those were carried by American troops on the D-Day invasion. Most of them threw the masks away and used them to carry their cigarettes and their socks and things in those bags because they were waterproofed. The suit on the right is a British anti-chemical warfare suit that was issued in 1970. This is a what's called an NBC or nuclear biological chemical marking set. And the flags, when you see the exhibition, some of you have seen it before. I know some of our volunteers have been in there and seen it. But these were the flags that were pulled out to mark where area might have been exposed. And there was even a little crayon in there. You could write on the flag what kind of gas you thought it was. And I thought it was ironic that from World War I, but the crayon in this marking kit was actually made in Germany. And then these are modern gas that are from the U.S. Army Chemical Corps Museum. The one on that side, the black one, is the U.S. Model 50, which is the one that's still issued to troops today. The Model 51 is issued to Navy troops. And you can see that it hasn't varied too much from that original idea of the filter. Here's on the sides. This one does even have a drinking tube on it, so that if you had to have your mask on for a while, you could have a drink while you kept your mask on. It is really cool. It's very lightweight, and it really is not affected by any of the chemical agents that could be thrown against it. The one next to it is a Russian mask from the late 1960s. It was brought back to the U.S. by a U.S. soldier from Vietnam, and the can itself had Vietnamese writing on it. The one next to it is an Iraqi mask that was brought back from a Desert Storm. And you can't see it in this picture, but if you're in the exhibit, and if you look right above where the glass mask, the viewpoint is, you can see the Iraqi symbol on the top there. Then the chemical detection kit that's on the right, with me looking at this laptop computer, it looks like a lot more sophisticated than that was, and you would actually put these strips in it, and it would run this little thing around, and it would determine what kind of chemical you were dealing with. And this is from late 40s, 1950s. Okay, that kind of gives you a real quick summation of how it got here and how we put the exhibition together. And if you haven't seen it, you have until June 3rd.
And if there are questions, I'm going to come to you with a microphone so that people can hear it. And while I'm waiting and walking over to my questions, if you want to find out more about some of what's currently going on, at the end of March, we've got a gentleman from MRI Global that Doran was kind enough to introduce me to, who's going to be part of our rapid fire talks, talking about the front line right now of protection and detection of chemical weapons at the end of the month.
What gases other than mustard gas were supposedly used in World War I?
Okay. There were three types of poison gas. There were lots of ones, derivations from them, but there were three main types. There was phosgene, chlorine, and mustard. Mustard gas was, we call it a gas, but it technically was an oil. And so it came in droplets, and it would settle on the ground or on equipment, on people's clothing, et cetera, and it was a burner. And so wherever it hit exposed skin or if it hit mucus around the eyes or around the nose or anything like that, then that's where it really burned. If it was swallowed, then it killed you, basically. The other two gases were respiratory gases. And so if they were inhaled, then they either killed you or they made you really sick. And so if you see in the painting Gassed, there are two fellows who are vomiting because of the effects of swallowing some of the mustard gas. Mustard gas can last for a long time. The vapor gases, chlorine and phosgene, would actually dissipate in the wind or if there was humidity or anything like that. So they didn't really last for a long time, but if you got hit right away with them, that was the first that was used. Chlorine was the first that was used in April of 1915. And both sides used all those. There was an artillery captain from Independence named Harry Truman. He fired lots of gas shells. So, nobody was an angel in all this. Just one fact, at the end of the war, the American stockpile had enough poison gas to kill every German four times over. And we're still finding these stockpiles. But mustard gas shells, which is why we tell our folks when we take them on the battlefield tours, don't touch shells, because if it's a mustard gas shell, it's still hot 100 years after the fact. The other two other kinds, they're gone. They don't have anything in them, but mustard gas is still there. And so you have to be, that's why they have demineurs that come and pick those bloody things up. Mm-hmm. Yes?
What type of gas did Saddam Hussein use against the Kurds? And is there any new types of gas that might be stockpiled for future wars?
Yes. To your second part, your second question. There's lots of it stockpiled. The Americans came up with a gas called Eberite, and that's basically a derivation of the Fajin gas, and that's what was used in the Iraq-Iran war, because he got it from us.
And I'm going to make another plug as I walk over here. In April, we are going to have the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Richard General Myers. We will have the current president of MRI Global, Mr. Tom Sachs, and the president of the Bio-Agro Defense Facility. And he's got a really interesting story about something that just came out of that they just discovered in Afghanistan. So if I haven't said enough to have you all check our website regularly, I don't know what to do.
Well, just one comment on that. You thought you came here to get away from commercials on television? Not when Laura's around, you know. She barely lets me talk for her while she's giving her commercials. Hi, Bill. How are you?
Fine. In one of the books in the volunteer lounge, there is a photograph that looks just like this painting. It shows all these men standing and hand on shoulder. Did Sergeant use a photograph for his painting?
No, he used the drawings that he made, and you can tell a lot of that because he drew the equipment. And for a material culturalist like me, the equipment that's in there is incredibly detailed. I mean, even the color of the enameled top of the canteens is correct. So he knew, and he wouldn't have gotten that from a photograph because they didn't had that kind of photography. But you're right, that photograph is a real famous photograph, and that was about 1917, I think. So it was a little bit earlier than that. He could have seen it, but I really, from looking at all his drawings, I think he really used the drawings. Yes?
How many soldiers were permanently injured from the mustard gas?
You know, I don't know. There are probably figures for that, this is not sounding trite. This is kind of one of my jokes. I'm going to see if it works. But I follow Mark Twain's statement that there are lives, damned lives, then statistics. So that's kind of how I regard statistics. When somebody shows me a whole pile of statistics and everything, I just kind of glaze over and say, let me look at some hand grenades. You know, that's. But there were a lot. Poison gas was never a major weapon. It was too hard to control because it depended too much on the weather. So it really was intended as a terror weapon. You couldn't stand there and wait for it to come at you. You could hide in your trench from artillery rounds, maybe, but you couldn't hide in your trench from poison gas. And so, you know, when you got out of the trench to run away from it, that's when the machine guns came into play. So that's really what it was intended for, was really as a terror weapon. It probably, I don't know exactly, but I'd say probably 5% of the deaths were from poison gas, from what I've been able to see over the years. Yes, sir.
Were the injuries from mustard gas permanent?
It depended. The blindness could be temporary. The burns, if it wasn't on bare skin, probably was also not permanent. But if it was on bare skin, it probably did leave scars. But on the eyes, if they got them treated, and it depended on how much they got hit by, it could be temporary. And they washed their eyes out with bicarbonate of soda. And that was really what the treatment that they had. And it worked. But if it had been on there too long, And the other reason you see them with, the, as Tonks said, the lint on their face, was because the sun would exacerbate the burning process. And so it could have been temporary. Some of them that were there in line probably recovered from it right when they got in the tent. And when you see those wires that come down on the side, that's the dressing station, the tent for it. But, you know, Sargent didn't have enough brown paint, I guess, to paint all the that big tent there. Yes, sir.
Some of the inhaled gases, I think, were affected the neurological system, sometimes called nerve gases.
Yes.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, nerve gases. There was also, they also called them tear gas. And choking gases, it was all basically the same.
It would send the recipient into convulsions.
Yes.
And eventually.
Yes.
And then a second question.
I knew there was going to be a doctor here.
No, not a doctor. No, a long time ago, I was a munitions officer in the Air Force. And we studied about nerve gas.
Sure. And it was basically.
It showed films of nerve gas on animals, and it was disgusting.
Yeah.
Second question, what sort of a bond or insurance do you have to put up to have this?
More than you can imagine.
I can imagine, yeah, right.
I'm not going to tell you what it is.
That's the attorney in me asking the question.
Yeah, well, our financial vice president is back in the back, and I'm not going to tell you while he's in here, because he doesn't want to write the check, so. Yes.
How did Sargent come to paint the guest?
He looked at a lot of scenes, and he you couldn't really paint a battle scene because you couldn't get that close while one was going on. And he wanted something to show the pathos of what was occurring, and he wanted to show the humanity. And so that's when he got there, he knew exactly that's what he wanted to paint. Yes, he was commissioned. He was commissioned by the British government for a large memorial painting for the Hall of Memories, which later became then the Imperial War Museum. And yeah, he was commissioned. He was commissioned actually in 1917, and he kind of procrastinated. So it took him about a year to get over there and actually see what to paint. And we're glad that he really saw what he did, because that really represents an incredible scene of what humans can do to other humans. Mm-hmm. And talking about animals, the animals were really affected by this. And you saw the picture I showed there of the horse with the gas mask. And they said, well, why isn't it over its eyes? Well, it doesn't have tear ducts. And so it wasn't affected by the tear gases. Now, mustard gas, it burned them and it killed them, and that was just it. But about 4 million horses and mules were killed in the war, primarily from artillery. So yeah, the horses and mules were the ones that really should be featured in a lot of this stuff, which is why we have two pictures in there of them.
Now, I know that there are some more questions, but I believe our senior curator will be happy to take them afterwards. Will you please join me in thanking senior curator Doran Cart?
Thanks.